Kia ora and welcome to the TVNZ multi-party debate, where we hear from those who could be the power brokers after October 17. There are five party leaders with me tonight. They have met the criteria to be part of the debate. Just like other years, we did invite Labor and National to be part of this conversation, but they declined. I also want to mention we have sign language interpreters, so if you're deaf or hard of hearing, you can see them on Freeview Channel 200. So let's get into it. What I want to start off with is 30 seconds from each leader. I want your pitch from the voters. Let's start off with you, James Shaw, the leader or co-leader of the Green Party.
As we respond to COVID-19, we can take action on climate change. We can protect nature, and we can make sure that everyone has what they need to live a life with dignity. The Green Party will work in partnership with Labor and make sure that we go further and faster as we meet the challenges that we face. If the Greens don't make it back in, we do run the risk that one party will have all the power. Our planet is running out of time. Think ahead. Party vote Green.
All right, just on 30 seconds, you're practiced at this. Now from the Māori Party co-leader, John Tamihere.
Oh, Aotearoa whānui, kia ora tātou. Te kaiwhakawā, tēnā rā koe, mō ngā kaimahi rangatira, kei te mihi nunui ki a koutou. So, Māori Party, unlike any party here, for this particular election, because of the unusual landscape, all we're seeking is the candidate vote, the electorate vote. And you can go fishing whānau, and you can go fishing with these people around me, but remember, the Labor Party Māori members are all on the list and they're all into Parliament already. And MMP stands for More Māori in Politics.
That's a nice place to wrap it up. Good work on the 30 seconds. Winston Peters, New Zealand First Leader.
Well, for years we've defended vulnerable New Zealanders against economic and political extremes. With COVID and economic fear on everybody's mind, experience and common sense is needed in government now more than ever. We know that we're a rising underdog in this campaign, but far closer to influencing the next government than either the National or ACT Party. For most New Zealanders, we're the best bet for stable government. So take out some insurance, use your second vote, and party vote New Zealand First.
Now ACT Leader David Seymour.
Well, good evening. The consequences of COVID have been unimaginably hard for New Zealanders, but there's also an opportunity to rebuild a country we can all be proud of. That means confronting the new reality that this virus is not going anywhere and we must become smarter in the way we adapt. It also means being honest about the debt. Politicians must live within the same rules as everyone else. When money's tight, spend on necessities and cut out the waste. I'm asking you to give your party vote to ACT to elect a genuinely independent team to hold them all accountable.
Now, finally, from Jami-Lee Ross from Advance New Zealand.
Good evening, New Zealand. The Parliament needs a new voice and new representation in there. Advance New Zealand will be the party that can do that. All of the people to the left of me will be part of a government or are part of a government that would continue with lockdowns in New Zealand, that would continue with closed borders, that will hurt New Zealanders more in the long term than the virus ever would. We need to learn to live with the virus as a country, and Advance New Zealand has policies that would do that. We need new voices in the Parliament because we need to have a party there that will protect the rights and freedoms of New Zealanders, won't allow politicians to override that at will.
All right.
Advance New Zealand will do that.
Good. 30 seconds there. Well done on everyone. I very appreciate keeping to time. So really interesting pitches there. And we'll wade into some more of that later in the debate. But first tonight, I want to talk about the latest One News Colmar Brunton poll that came in just an hour ago. Let's go through the results. Labor is steady on 47. National drops 1 to 32. ACT is steady on 8. The Greens are on 6, down 1. New Zealand First is on 2, a bounce from 1. The Opportunities Party get 2. The New Conservatives and Advance New Zealand both on 1. On these numbers, there would only be Labor, National, ACT and the Greens in Parliament, and Labor would need the support from the Greens to govern. The Māori Party didn't register over 1% in this poll. So let's get into these numbers, James Shaw. On these numbers, Labor needs you. Do you now think you should have done a deal in Auckland Central so you'd be able to breathe a bit more easily?
No, we want to win Auckland Central on our merits, and Chloe is running an extraordinarily strong campaign there, and we're really proud of it.
Do you think you'll feel that way, though, if you're teetering around that 5% at the moment, and if you're sitting not being able to go back into Parliament on October 17?
Look, we know that we need to get every possible vote that we can, that we tend to, on the day, not quite get what we poll at, and so we've got to get out the vote and make sure that everybody gives us their party vote. That is the one that will ensure that we cross the 5% threshold, that we are part of the next parliament and part of the next government.
All right, John Tamihere, I want to be clear. Would you only work with Labor?
Yes.
So you will not be picking up the phone if Judith Collins comes ringing the day after the election?
No, and we stand a very good chance in a number of the Māori seats, solely because of the huge number of undecideds in our seven seats. And it's not the first time that the Māori Party or Māori members of Parliament have ensured that the Treasury benches are ruled.
And you're being so categorical this time because you were punished last election when after going with Nationals.
Well, I wasn't there then, but the reality is we have to win our people's vote back on the street. We're the only liberated voice for Māori. I know all my other Māori colleagues and other parties have to go in to a caucus room and get voted down. Will never be.
All right, Mr. Peters, you are sitting on 2%. Why are you losing?
Well, what a fascinating question to ask.
Thank you, Mr. Peters.
A party like New Zealand First, you've done it to me over and over again, and we're going to defy your polls.
And I have heard.
We're more concerned about the people. Now, don't say, but you can't write them off. We've defied these polls over and over again, and on my information, we're in a great shape and a surge going on as we speak. I'm confident of that. The people out there will decide this election, not pollsters.
One thing that's not working out for you are those charges with the SFO. One person appeared in court today fighting the suppression for the New Zealand First Foundation. That's damaging for you, isn't it?
Look, we're not going to have trial by media or trial by the mob in this country. And out there are fair-minded New Zealanders who know that, for a start, every member of my party has been exonerated, and that they believe that you're innocent until being proven guilty. I've welcomed the Serious Force Office inquiry from day one, and I welcome its outcome. Let me tell you one thing. I've got rid of two former Serious Force leaders. Two, not one. And I'm not concerned about this at all in the remotest idea. I know the facts, and you can run your attack, and they can all attack me and New Zealand First. They did it in 2008. It was a lie.
All right.
They were not going to get away with this time.
All right, David Seymour, I want to ask you about your spending. You want an austerity budget. You want to cut spending. Is that going to be a bottom line if you're in a position to negotiate with National?
Well, if you see ACT and National sitting down, one of the things ACT will be bringing to the table is that politicians do have to live within the same rules as everybody else.
So will it be a bottom line?
Every business, every household. What it means is that we'll be a voice around the table saying it's not fair on the next generation to be saddled with the amount of debt there is. And I'm seeing more and more young parents.
But I want to know about the bottom line. Are you going to say
Well, it clearly is a bottom line if that's the way you want to play it. Because I see more and more people, young parents with prams and pushchairs, coming to political meetings because they're worried about the future. They understand that there are people, young New Zealanders learning to walk right now, who will get a driver's license before this government balances
the
budget.
Jami-Lee Ross, you are facing fraud charges. You've been accused of bullying your staff. Do you have the right credentials to be a member of Parliament?
Yes, I was a whistleblower when it came to the National Party. Labor and National are bought and sold by Chinese Communist Party linked money. I blew the whistle on it. I'd do it again. And innocent until proven guilty, by the way. Look,
something to agree with Mr. Peters on there, I guess.
Well, look, Advance New Zealand, we're on track to win the Tītai Tokoro seat. That will mean there will be representation there in the Parliament. And so Advance New Zealand does offer something new and different. It offers an ability to ensure we don't have a government that locks New Zealanders down anymore.
All right.
We need to open those borders.
I've got a few people shaking their heads over that one. We'll come to
that a bit later on. So.
But after the break, we're going to be talking about how we live with COVID-19. I've got a few curly questions coming up too, so stay with us. Welcome back. Zero cases of community transmission again today. Arguably, New Zealand has done a good job with COVID-19, not perfectly, but compared to most countries, we're doing well. But what comes next is really crucial. David Seymour, I want to put this question to you first. You've been very critical of the government's response, but aren't we doing a pretty good job with COVID-19?
Well, I've offered constructive criticism where necessary and made helpful suggestions where possible. We've never said it's easy and that the government are all incompetent, but what we have said is that, let's face it, we're an island nation that's very spread out, with a young population. We did start with some natural advantages. Then we say we went hard and went early. Actually, we're the 63rd country to get it. We say we have gold standard contact tracing, and yet one outbreak leads to 6 to 8 weeks of restrictions. I think we need to do better, and that means we need to get Taiwan smart so that we can maintain elimination with no more lockdowns.
But you talk about Taiwan there. Didn't Taiwan do a good job because they allow the government to access their data through their phones? And is ACT comfortable with that here in New Zealand?
There's clearly going to be a trade-off between privacy and public health.
And you're prepared to make that trade-off?
Absolutely. It is very possible to protect people's privacy. You look at COVID card, for instance.
Right.
It doesn't store individualised data. So technology can actually have a win-win with privacy and
Mr. Peters,
health.
You were sitting at the top table. Is David Seymour right?
No, he's wrong. The reality is that New Zealand has done marvellously well, and the Prime Minister exceptionally, but it was an all-of-government experience with no playbooks or no manual. And we could have done things better, but overall, we've done marvellously. We must not get loose and get careless now. Look, France has gone into lockdown as we speak. Today, Scotland went into lockdown as we speak. These cavalier people who say there's nothing to fear, look around the whole world, 79,000 cases as we speak today in India, and think it's a small thing. We are fighting a battle against evil here. We can win, but we've got to be cohesive. At the same time, we can't be too careful so that we choke the economy and people die for other causes.
James Shaw, what do you make of David Seymour's comments around Taiwan?
Well, David is putting different sets of facts together. He says that we were the 63rd country to get it. That is true, but we actually went into lockdown when we had very few cases. That's what we mean when we're going hard and early, is the proximity to when you first, when it's first in the community in New Zealand. And so I do think that we've had an incredibly strong response. You know, there are fewer cases in New Zealand at the moment than there are in the White House. The COVID card that he's talking about is going to go through testing, and we do want to see if we can do that. But I find it extraordinary that a Libertarian Party that stands up for, the kind of freedoms that David keeps banging on about would be willing to countenance the idea that the government should be able to track people through their data on their phones.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, first of all, we've got to end the fear factory. We heard from Winston, he compares us to the worst. We've got to start comparing ourselves with the best. And it is possible to anonymise data in a way that you can detect people who have it, but not actually give their privacy away. It's not just that Taiwan did, though. There's a number of things.
Well, he stumbled onto something that's right. I think the Morgan card, the app, would have been far more appropriate, and I think we should have gone with it because far better people and far
so
more
why
IT.
Why didn't
can
you
I,
then?
Can I just say, you were
at that top table.
Well, I wasn't. If we stand around and try and blame everybody for the failures, then who's going to take the credit for the successes? I don't see you saying, Winston, it was great that you were saying. But I want to make this point. We should have gone better with the app. We should have got the army in earlier, and we should have used masks much earlier. But having said that, we have done phenomenally well.
John Tamihere.
Yeah, look, the ACT view is always one of privilege and entitlement. To just say, bang, this is what we want, this is how it's going to go. And they're able to do that because they represent the rich and the powerful who are very well looked after at the top end of town.
That doesn't explain why we invested in charter schools, put all our political capital into schools.
Let him finish and I'll come back to you. John Tamihere, you finish and I'll come back to you.
Yeah, that's right. You want to behave yourself.
It's not all about that, come on.
So the point is that it's his privilege and his entitlement. Comes out all the time.
All right, let him have a quick reply and then I'll come to you. Very, very quick.
Well, there's a rich irony. I'm not into assassinating people's character, but if you want to talk about my track record, I put all my political capital into charter schools so the most disadvantaged students could have opportunity to learn and ultimately feel good about themselves.
And you're on the record for that. Jami-Lee Ross, I want to come and ask a question to you. You held a rally with thousands of people in Level 2. Was that responsible?
It was the right thing to do, because what these guys are not answering is what the long-term consequences of the government's decisions are. How many people have lost their businesses and will lose their businesses?
Was it responsible, though, to get a large crowd of people together when we were told not to?
It was, because New Zealanders want to stand up to what's going on right now. What's going on is lockdowns at any cost. And the long-term consequences of the decisions that have been made by this government will be more people will lose their jobs, more people won't be able to pay the rent or the mortgage. Hold on, Jess, let me answer the question. More people will lose their livelihoods, and how many suicides will happen? How many people won't get cancer?
All right, John Tamihere, can you respond to that?
Just quickly, across the other side of town, Māori TV is running a debate for Te Tai Tokirau. His party, 0% in the polling up there. Right? There's no way that Mr. Advance over there is going to get anywhere. Wow. So our people are...
Can I just say, look,
look, we were in the COVID-19 crisis, knowing that in 1918, the decimation of Māori, 8-9 times worse than Europeans, and possibly in South Auckland and other places where we had Pacifica, would be terrible for our country. We fronted up to that fear, and others said that it was a hoax. I cannot believe any serious New Zealander would think that's the right
way
to go.
Very quickly, James Shaw.
We are the only country in the world where the death rate went down during a global pandemic. And to one of Jamie's points, actually, the suicide rate is down over the same time last year. So it's you should not believe everything you read on the internet.
I want to ask a question and put it to all of you about a vaccine and when it's produced. Would you all take it, and should it be compulsory? James Shaw, I'll start with you.
I would take it. We don't believe in compulsory vaccines in this country.
John Tamihere.
Exactly the same.
Same position? Good agreement.
Same position,
yeah. Mr. Peters?
Oh, God help us, we're all praying for it. Of course I'll take it.
And do you have, in the next year, is that what your thinking is?
Well, the problem is, look, we still haven't got a vaccine for HIV after 4 decades, but I hope in the modern context that we'll make it. But if we don't, we still cannot afford to actually demoralise and devastate our people by stupid, off-the-wall ideas.
Mr. Seymour, would you take the vaccine, and should it be compulsory?
Well, I'd want to know that it was safe first, but yes, of course. And I don't think it should be compulsory. That's not something we believe in.
Jami-Lee Ross?
No, because I wouldn't take a rushed vaccine. The case fatality rate for the flu and COVID-19 are not too dissimilar. Look, we'll see over time, but if this thing's going to be rushed, and we have to point out, the case fatality rate for the flu and COVID-19 around the world is roughly similar. Would
Just
you lock down the country
record,
for the
how
flu?
Do you feel about vaccines generally?
Look, my children are vaccinated, I'm vaccinated. It should be about choice. We should never have discrimination.
I mean, that's not the policy of your party and not the beliefs of some members of your party.
No, our party's view is that it should be about choice. There shouldn't be discrimination. We shouldn't take people's benefits away, which some parties around here want to do.
All right.
It should be about medical freedom.
OK, well, thank you very much for all of those answers. Stay with us. Who has the best plan for the economy, and who will inspire you with their ideas? That's up next. Welcome back. COVID-19 is seen by many as an opportunity to do things better. So I'm going to ask all of the parties now about a new or innovative policy or idea that their party would bring to the table to try and speed up our economic recovery. James Shaw, I'll start off with you. What's your pitch? What's your pitch to get New Zealanders excited or get voters excited?
Well, Jess, in every category of infrastructure, we had a historic underspend. It wasn't keeping up with population growth. You look at the pipes under our feet, our housing stock, our schools and our hospitals, every category of transport, except for a few roads of national significance, we just weren't keeping up. You know, we were crowing about having a low debt to GDP ratio. What we need to do is to make sure that every dollar of the stimulus spend that we're putting towards the COVID recovery goes towards resolving those long-term challenges facing New Zealand, which is why we're asking New Zealanders to think ahead.
David Seymour, you don't want big spending in those areas, do you? You'd cut those.
Well, actually, our infrastructure plan is to structure infrastructure investment better over 30 years with a partnership between central and regional government. So infrastructure is important, but actually there's no silver bullet to economic redevelopment. What we need is for one New Zealander to offer another New Zealander a job hundreds of thousands of times. One way you can stimulate that is to cut GST from 15% down to 10% for a year.
The silver bullet line was actually one Mr. Peters used in the break there.
Yeah.
Can I just finish?
GST was brought in by the first leader of the ACT Party and put up to 12.5% by the second leader of the ACT Party, and now he's asking us to believe he's going to take it down to 10%. Look,
sometimes
that's buying the
go
sky
full circle.
And as for a silver bullet, I said it because, look, the biggest thing coming for us is how we handle debt. Debt, if it's for productivity, added value, wealth creation, exports, manufacturing and jobs, fantastic. If it's for consumption and some of the big government socialist spend up that I'm hearing, then we are in for disaster.
Mr. Tamihere.
Yeah, listen, whilst it's a good question, our children can't participate in any economy. Well, 80% of them are in decile 1 to 3 schools. 70% of them will not pass with a qualification. That's not because they're dumb Māoris. It's not because they're silly. It's not because their parents don't love them and get them to school. It's because, depending on where you go to school, depends on whether you make it in any economy.
Idea?
In any economy.
So what's your innovative idea? Or what
want to resource.
People.
No, I'm not interested in the innovative ideas at this stage because we can't participate in the economy. Because the basic education system in this country does not get us work ready regardless of what it is. So what we've got to do in the Māori Party is just speak our truth, which is that we want our children educated the same as kids in decile 9 and 10 schools. And why is that wrong?
James Shaw, a question for you. Mm. Businesses are really struggling at the moment. When you look at the list of things that you want to do, you want to extend the living wage, boost annual leave by 5 weeks, increase sick leave for 10 days. Don't you need to give businesses a break at this time?
Well, the reason that we want to increase sick leave is because when you've got a global pandemic on, and we've actually seen this over the last 6 months, you have people who were refusing to go for testing or staying away from it because they were worried that if they got sent home that they wouldn't have a job to come back to. And so what we're saying is, like, right now is exactly the time when you actually need people to have those kinds of protections. And I think that the idea, when you've got, you know, a huge stimulation
so
going on of the part of
the
asset
part. All right, we've got to go to Daily Moore and then we'll get your response.
I mean, that's a very good example of the kinds of costs being put onto business that make it harder for them to employ people. Extra public holidays, extra sick leave, putting up the minimum wage, more compliance, more tax. All of those things make it harder for people to create jobs and raise wages. ACT says we should actually be reducing tax.
All right.
We should be allowing businesses to depreciate $150,000 off the bat, because
all
at the moment we have far too much
David.
Expense.
All of these are irrelevant because all of them would continue with lockdowns and the border being closed. You can't grow an economy with our borders closed when we rely on tourism so much. We would look at more quantitative easing. That's important, and the US is doing it, Canada, the UK. These guys will all rack up more and more debt, and that's irresponsible.
Mr. Peters.
Just 2 nights ago, the Australian government, more akin to the ACT Party, but far more akin to perhaps the National Party, when it was a common sense party, brought in a program against austerity, brought in a program to spend money to grow and a larger debt to get out of this wealth
And a few heads nodding.
So did the British. And along comes the Seymour from the neoliberal experiment of 35 years ago, spouting the same old rubbish.
You're Are you getting that message across, though, Mr Peters? Because, I mean, the ACT Party is sitting with 11 MPs. Well,
I just can't believe Winston Peters is calling me out of date.
all with the training wheels on. Below him, you've got no idea what they intend to put on the backbench remotely in opposition because they've got no chance of being in government.
All right, well, let's put that question to you, David Seymour. Mm. You want to introduce big spending cuts. You want benefit cuts. Mm. You want to get rid of the winter energy payment to freeze the minimum wage. Mm. Aren't these the people who are really hurting under COVID-19?
Not at all. We're taking benefit levels, for example, back to the level that they were at under Jacinda Ardern and Grant Robertson and these guys, remember, for their first two budgets. If it's so bad, then we should blame them.
Let's bring in John Tamihere.
We have the wealth gap, the inequality gap in this country. We've got to set a new moral compass in this election to look after those more vulnerable. Because you know what? On deficit costs alone, 2 years of corrections cost more than all of the treaty settlements in the last 26 years. How dumb is that approach from ACT?
Mr. Shaw.
About 3 weeks ago, the New Zealand Stock Exchange had a record historic high. House prices are up, house valuations are up about 15% on average around the country over the same time last year. And at exactly the same time, wage and salary earners saw the median wage drop by 7.5%. It was the first drop in recorded history. So the wage and salary earners on the one hand are getting squeezed. Assets and people with wealth and property on the other hand are
actually seeing... And we'll talk more about that.
But what I'm saying is that David's completely incorrect when he said that it is the wage and salary earners who are doing fine. They are not doing fine.
One of the things that I want to talk about as well as superannuation. So I want to move on to superannuation. And this question for you, Mr. Peters.
Thank you very much.
You're most welcome. Is it responsible for us not to look at readjusting the criteria for super, given the climate that we're in and given that people are working far beyond 65 now?
Look, every time this country, long time before now, got into any sort of economic difficulty, they came straight for the young and the old. And be warned if you're...
But isn't it the younger generation that are hurting from superannuation?
No, I just said that. The reality is we are way below the international cost of superannuation. We're at about 4.4% of GDP. And here's the point. If you thought we should make all those changes, which are not huge, if you thought we should make all those changes, why did we allow 90,000 people under the former Labor and National governments to come into power, this is not now, but to come into this country after 10 years, get full super, whether they paid any tax or not. And they said, the Māori Party said, we should be going to the airport and giving them a forfeit.
Your response, Mr. Tamihere?
No. Every time Mr. Peters has promised to curb immigration, it's gone through the roof.
It hasn't. It's gone down.
That's point one. No, well, it has because we've closed our borders. But prior to that, 2 years prior to that, went north. But here's the thing, right, in terms of where we're all riding, okay? We've got to bridge the gap between the rich and the poor in this country. And you can't pull the ladder up just because you're at the top of it. When we went to housing with James here, you know, every year it's just a casino where you can gamble and never lose. I do want to talk more about housing later.
One question that I did want to reasonably swiftly canvass with you is, does New Zealand need to move faster on reducing its emissions, even if it causes economic pain in the short term?
No.
Why do you say no?
No, because the approaching the emissions trading scheme and the climate policies, that actually costs the economy, costs jobs, all because we want to go after a nice goal. But actually, New Zealand's emissions are just like a day of China's. Yeah. We need to actually pull out of them
and look after our economy first.
Yes, the countries that have actually successfully reduced their emissions whilst growing their economy have said that it has gone far faster and far cheaper than all of their most optimistic modelling. The UK, up until Brexit, had the fastest growing economy in the G20 and also at the same time reduced its emissions by 40%. It's a total false dichotomy. A low emission economy is a high productivity, high wage, high innovation, high tech economy.
You want to kill agriculture,
James. He has a point there. Well, agriculture is still part of the ETS. That's a failure, isn't it?
Agriculture is not. Yeah. No. So what we need to do is to have a farm level...
Sorry, what I meant to say was not part of the ETS.
But what we are doing, and we're working in partnership with the agricultural sector, is to develop a system that farmers can use to measure all of sources of emissions and the sinks of emissions.
Good sense of debate. I'm so sorry, Mr. Peters. We do have to go to a break. I will come back to you afterwards. Stay with us. Can we build back better? Is this an opportunity for New Zealand? That's next. Welcome back. Even before COVID-19, New Zealand had some deep-seated problems that successive governments have failed to fix. So I want to start with housing, because yet again we're seeing house prices boom and young people wondering if they'll ever be able to afford a home. Now, Mr. Peters, I want to start off with you, and I'll put this to the rest of you as well. Would you ever look to introduce a policy that would bring house prices down?
Well, what we're going to do is stabilise things for a start. What we've got, the problem we've got is we inherited a massive problem of huge demand and very little supply. And although the Housing Corporation did great and private industry's done great, we've built more since 1974 than ever before, we are way behind the demand ball still. So we need an inquiry into the cost of housing construction. We need a
Do you think that a policy should be put in place, or would you ever support one to bring prices down? Because it's difficult, isn't it?
Well, if you want to bring prices down, I can tell you to do it tomorrow. You put a certain parties in government and the prices are going to come soaring down, but they will
what
not...
What do you mean by that?
Well, the prices will come soaring down, but poor people or moderate income people will not be able to buy them. I mean by that, we were the most successful country in the world from the late 30s all the way to the 70s, and then we lost the plot on this matter. That's we can recover from it.
But right.
Back then, it was much more cheaper to buy a house, four times your annual income,
right.
And 30% of your
weekly
income
for services.
Yeah, look, the Multiparty policy is pretty simple, right? You have to curb immigration to allow our demand to meet our supply requirements, right? He still brings in heaps of immigrants, right? Second thing is, you have to
better late than never.
You have to tax the second.
But don't we need immigrants to fuel our economy? Isn't that what we need to do to get
going? Well, here's the thing. We get 300,000 temporary workers displacing our people all the time coming in.
All
slave
right.
labour. You've got 90...
I mean, we digress, because, I mean, in terms of with Māori, they're overrepresented in the poor stats when it comes to home ownership. So what would your party do to get more Māori into homes, into Nothing. Owning their
no,
own
no,
homes?
No, I've just indicated that you have to change the policy settings. You have to put GST in, because the wage and salary earner is going nowhere. You've got assets that continue to increase and they're never taxed.
All right, let's hear over here.
Well, no one can afford to buy a home when they can't have a job because of their COVID economic policies. What we need to do is flood the market with supply, rip up the RMA.
All right.
We'd go with a shared equity scheme as well.
David Seymour.
Look, first of all, this is actually a real problem. You know, 30 years ago, the poorest New Zealanders spent a quarter of their income on housing costs. Now it's over half. And if you want to know why we have kids living in cars and garages and don't have enough money, that simple fact is the biggest single problem we have if we want a more equal New Zealand. So it's a problem that needs to be solved.
All right.
Now you've also got to ask how you solve it. It's simply too hard to build homes. We need the next generation.
We need the next generation to build homes, and that means better infrastructure funding.
Housing crisis started under his first party leader, Roger Douglas. That's what happened.
All right. That's on the record, Mr. Peters.
Well, we know that. And then we had to bring in family support to prop up a failed economy. Mm. And they're still preaching that sort of language.
All right,
they
Mr.
started
Short,
it.
Yes. What's your response?
Everybody here has agreed that we do need to build more housing supply. The one way to do that is to ensure that actually we build more state houses. You can actually bring down the median house price by ensuring that you're getting more supply at the bottom end of the market. That is what we're committed to doing. We think that we can build about 5,000 houses a year
why
over the next few years and clear that.
housing list.
What do you say to that question? The state shouldn't be the solution to everything. All right.
But
I want to touch
John's point, we can have papa kāinga housing, and actually I think that this kāinga order can do a great deal to support both community housing providers, iwi,
the reality is if the rules aren't right, you
but
can't
we want to make sure
land,
that those community housing
state
providers
or private.
Are supported.
You've got to get those
things.
All right, I want to, and I'll just remind you, the audience at home can't hear if we talk over each other, but I want to move on to a different topic. And John Tamihere, central to your party is to have Māori problems solved by Māori.
Correct.
Do we need a separate system? Is that the best way
to do it? No, it's not a separate system. The way people pitch that one is, I remember when I took my baby into Kawangareo, and my mates, Pākehā mates, good mates, said to me, why are you separating from us? Why are you putting your baby into Kawangareo? No, I said to them, no, you're separated me from my culture and my language and who I am and the land of my ancestors. So what non-Māori Pākehā people have to understand is, don't separate us from our ability to get out of grinding poverty, to manage ourselves out of welfareism and into employment.
What's your response, Mr. Peters? Do we need to try something different?
Look, my response is this, and there's been no organisation in this country where you've seen the lack of separatism and the sense of unity as our army. And Robert Muldoon once asked General Pōnanga, the head of the army, where many Māori have got to the top, not like any other profession, but in the army they have, he asked, how many Māori have you got in the army? And Pōnanga's answer is still relevant today. He said, Mr. Prime Minister, we just have soldiers in our army.
So encouraging Māori to join up to the army?
No. I'm saying
separatism.
I'll make the point with the same one. The last thing I need is you to speak for me.
Well, you need
I mean, you haven't been around long enough, but here's the point here. The truth of the matter is that separatism and division in this COVID-19 crisis is the last thing we want. Cohesion's critical. If we start giving out wealth on the basis of race, we're heading for disaster.
David Seymour, what did you want to add in there?
Oh, just that housing policy is worth talking about, and it is about replacing the RMA with an Urban Development Act that prioritises
free
and
open.
Oh, we heard that.
Well, not everyone has, Jess, and it's worth talking about. It is about an infrastructure policy that coordinates central and local government to get it built, and it is about getting councils out of building inspections because they created leaky buildings and they're hopeless. That's not true at all, James. You guys have had 3 years and done nothing towards
this. And why didn't you do it?
So we had the Tony Randerson review, which gave us the guidance on how to do it. And now that we've gone through that process, we'll be moving on it as soon as we form a government.
Why was it not a priority?
It is a priority.
But why was it not able to be achieved in those 3 years?
Well, because the RMA is an astonishingly complicated act. It's at least twice the length that it was when it was written back in 1990. And we wanted to make sure that we did a really good job of it. That's why we got Tony Randerson QC to lead that review of it and to provide Parliament with some guidance.
I was really trying not to focus too much on the RMA, but here we are.
It's with unavoidable.
This. What I want to do, you're right, it is unavoidable. What I want to ask is a swift question again at the back of this. Should private schools get government funding? James Shaw.
Our government has said no.
John Tamihere?
No.
Well, he said the green school is private. It should get government money. But we believe that, of course, private schools should get government money because if we were to put them all into the state, the cost would be prohibitive right now. This is not practical talk.
All right.
Well, the schools he's talking about are the integrated schools, which are private schools, but they form part of the
state. Yeah, hey, can we go?
David Seymour, your swift response.
The students' parents pay tax like everyone else, so of course they should. An ex-student education account policy would let you take your share of the education funding
is good.
To school
another
of your choice,
policy.
Public or private.
And now Jami-Lee Ross.
We need to support state integrated schools more and those schools like charter schools, which do take people out of the public system. They actually save taxpayers' money.
Excellent. We'll pause there. Final questions for our candidates after the break. Welcome back. This is our final section, so I want to keep things moving. So we'll have some quick answers to these questions, hopefully. The first question I want to ask, and I'll start with you, Mr. Shaw, do you think that we should have quotas for Māori and Pacific students when it comes to med school?
I do think that if you if you do that, then it's actually an obligation to go out and find students. And I think actually we do need to bring more Māori and Pacific into the system.
Yeah, I was at university when we campaigned to get a quota system in. And the reason for that is that we come from poor schools, and so we're not ripe enough to get the type of grades to get entry. But here's the beauty about it. Our failure rate, once we get entry, is extraordinarily low. And so if you want equity in this country and you want equality in this country, that's what we have to have.
Do you agree with quotas, Mr. Peters?
Teach them properly at preschool, primary school and secondary school, and you wouldn't need that sort of talk.
Quotas don't sit comfortably with you?
Well, the fact is that this tokenism, how does a Māori feel because he's there, because somebody said, you're in a different category, you can't learn fast enough.
The Pākehā's got
goodness. Well, the Pākehā's all three got there, not on a quota. Yeah. They became lawyers.
It's not a function.
Avra Nangata got his degree in law in 2 years. Stop putting Māori down. Teach them properly at preschool, secondary school.
All right, you have said that. Mr. Shaw, jump in here.
But it's not actually a function. I mean, they are being taught by good teachers in good schools. It's a function of the socioeconomic background that people have.
And who taught their parents?
It proves that over and over again, that you need to take care of people's housing, of their incomes, of the context with which they're being educated.
All right, I want to switch topics to China, and I will come to you, Jami-Lee Ross, for this one as well. Is New Zealand too dependent on China? And do we not call China out enough about its human rights issues?
No, we don't. We were one of the last countries to call China out over COVID-19. And too much overseas money flows into our politics. That corrupts the political system. What we do have, what we've also done, is we've put too many eggs in the China basket. We need to expand our trade agreements to our more traditional trading partners.
All right.
And I think we also need to come down hard on China and not be afraid of them like so many people on this panel have been in the past.
Mr. Peters, what do you say to that?
Jami-Lee Ross and I have seen the level of money and the connections, the wiring diagrams to China, and I don't see it in the media and I don't see it in the serious foreign office. I think this is catastrophically bad. Second, of course we've got too much dependence of one market, and they walked into it without, New Zealanders did, and government said without their eyes wide open, they were always going to be outsmarted by the Chinese. Don't blame the Chinese, blame our past leadership. It didn't have the presence of mind to understand where they're going.
But to be fair,
I've called them out on the Uyghurs, I've called them out when it comes to the Spratly Islands, I've called them out all around the world where that's been wrong. No, and they've made numerous complaints about me, but I've kept my country's independence. That's new now, but it wasn't that way before I got a job.
Look, when Winston has warned the Chinese, their knees are really knocking, aren't they? I mean, for goodness sakes. They're an outstanding and huge economy, and we need to trade with it. It's as simple as that. And it shouldn't be racial. See, this is Trumpism starting to play out. You've got to be very careful about
it. Jami-Lee Ross, what do you say to that?
Well, I say that John Tamihere doesn't care about the Māori who miss out because of the way in which we approach the Chinese government. We should actually be looking at more trade agreements with the UK, with the US. We should be looking at how we can expand those opportunities. We're not taken seriously enough as a country anymore because of our dependence on China.
I do want to move on to another topic. When the Queen dies, is it time for New Zealand to become a republic? Mr. Tamihere, thumbs up from you.
Oh, look, God bless the Queen and all that stuff, she lives 12,000 miles away. For goodness sakes, the closest I've ever come to is licking a stamp, back of her head on a stamp. So you know, the point is that we are our own sovereign peoples now. We're old enough to actually embark on our own conversation.
David, what's your take on this?
Well, look, it's a horrible thing to say. I hope she's not thinking of us dying. I would say that's probably a long way down the list of priorities for New Zealand right now. I wouldn't mind coming back to China, though, because that is important. We have become heavily dependent economically on China. The CCP is an organisation that does not share many of our values. We are going to have to very carefully pivot away from that dependence by diversifying our trade and investment.
Mr. Peters,
we need to
the National Party took them there when they were warned. So did Helen Clark in 2008 when we said, you're going to have to get a far better deal and that would be satisfactory. But on the question of the monarchy, look, When you're going for a vote in the UN, you're halfway there to get 150% by just having the Commonwealth on your side. But let's... Can I say, it's not what I and any of these guys think, because temporary and empowered anyway.
All right.
It's what the people think in a two-year referendum.
So, President, perhaps President Peters?
Well, now you're going to find out how expensive a presidency could be. That should be told to the New Zealand people as well.
All right. I do want to ask you all a final question. Since we're all gathered in this room, out of the people here, who would each of you be able to work with? Jami-Lee Ross, I'll start with you.
Well, I think we're taking a lot of Winston's voters, so there's a lot of similarity there. Yeah. But look, he's smart on China, but this government and past governments haven't done enough on it.
So who could you work with here?
Oh, look, I think they're all reasonable people.
Would any of you work with Jami-Lee
Ross? We actually need a government that doesn't continue to lock people down, doesn't continue to close the borders.
Mr. Peters, could you work with Jami-Lee Ross?
I don't want to close this serious debate when we were locked out of the other leaders' debate, don't forget, with a talk about who we're going to talk to here.
But it's really important who you're going to work with.
I'd like to close by saying how critical this vote is for this country, because it's a chance, if you make the wrong mistake...
Okay, if you're not keen to answer the question, that's okay. Mr. Seymour, who would you...
To be quite frank, they have to be in Parliament, and only James, who's teetering on the edge, is going to be on your poll tonight.
Oh,
ACT can work with National. We've done it before. We can't work with Labor because, frankly, there's a skill shortage in the Labor caucus. We can't rely on the people
who gave us Kiwi Bill to rebuild out of this crisis. The make-up here, because on those numbers, there's only two people in Parliament. In terms of the 5% threshold...
Excuse me, don't predicate the question on a false poll.
The 5%...
Don't predicate the question on a false poll.
I'm trying to get to the question, Mr. Peters. The 5% threshold, do you think it should be lowered?
No.
Why is that? Can you explain?
I've always believed, and we're the only party that said that, it was a new party. If you can't make 5%, you don't deserve to
Does anyone feel uncomfortable with the 5% threshold?
Yes.
It's too high.
Why do you?
Well, because there's two elections going on this election, every election, seven Māori seats and the general seats. We, as you know, in the polling, the polls are about Pākehā preference. It's got nothing to do with Māori, right? So we don't feature anyway. So what people have to understand is so long as we keep these seats, there's going to have to be a different number for Māori to get coattailing going on.
And James Shaw.
The 2012 review by the Electoral Commission said we should lower it to 4%, and we agree with the Electoral Commission. It was Judith Collins who killed that off because it didn't suit her party's interests at the time.
All right, well, we've still got a few more days of campaigning to go, but let us leave it there. Thank you to all of the parties for joining me tonight. I really appreciate your time. We're now 9 days till Election Day, although many of you have been getting in early to vote. I'll be back in a week for the final leaders' debate between Jacinda Ardern and Judith Collins. If you're undecided, this will be a chance for you to make up your mind. Thank you for the team here in the studio and in the control room. Good night.